It is far easier to train every single day than 3 days a week, man. Because when you're training every single day, there is no conversation in your mind. There's nothing. You know you're training every day. Maybe it's therapy as well. You know, some people go back to the bottle or to the smokes or whatever. And when I have a really shitty day, man, I just put 180 on the bar and do an AMRAP set, and then freaking hell, man, everything is mint. I feel bloody beautiful after that. I would spend an hour and a half doing these five sets. I just did one set and it took my soul. And I'm like, how am I going to do the next set?
All right. So I want to kick things off talking about the beginning of your YouTube journey, when that started with the Yugoslavia war and moving to Australia to start a new life. On the athletic side, you mentioned playing basketball at the age of 10 and eventually filling that void with training from bro splits to the Texas method. And your first video is actually on greasing the groove. So can you explain Greasing the Groove and the work of Pavel Tsouli in as much detail as possible?
Yeah. Oh, man, that takes me back. Greasing the Groove was basically the time when I fully let go of basketball. And that chapter fully closed. And it was around the time that my son was born, so 2016. I went out with the boys. He must have been like 2-3 months old. And this was the first time kind of like doing anything other than nappies and sleeping. And we went to the basketball court. We just played 3-on-3 with some of the fellas. And I rolled my ankle real bad, snapped one of the bones in my foot. And I was off my feet, 3-month-old baby at home. So then I just picked up a bunch of books and I started reading them. And one of the books that I downloaded was Power to the People by Pavel Tsouli. That was the first text that I read. And it absolutely blew my mind, man. Like, that is still the most recommended book that I say to people all the time. You know, if you want to read a book, if you want to read an author in this space, Pavel Tsouli is a mind like no other. And this was like my first real exposure to the Eastern world methodologies to training, weightlifting, training just in general in the gym. And he basically said, you know, if you want to get good at pull-ups, don't do pull-ups to failure. And I thought, well, how's this going to work, man? That's not going to work. Like, I always thought the last few reps is where the gains are. Nah, man, he said, grease the groove. So basically, greasing the groove is you work out your maximum repetitions. Let's say you can only do 20 push-ups. And you do 30 to 60%, although he basically says 30% of those repetitions. And you do those reps many, many, many times throughout the day. So accumulate 10, 15, 20 sets of these really, really light sets. And then throughout the days, throughout the weeks, you just keep accumulating. And eventually, after a bunch of weeks, when you kind of feel like it, jump up and see what your maximum reps are, and they will go up. That to me was like a concept that I've never heard about before. And it really kind of sparked my basketball brain, because that's kind of my background as a child. I started playing basketball, soccer, all that stuff. And I thought, my God, this is like practicing free throws.
Yeah.
This is like spotting up at the three-point line and catching, shooting, go left, go right, you know, bounce one left, bounce one right, pull up. This is practice, man. And then he goes on to explain that the neurological adaptations strength is a neurological and also muscular event. It's not just a muscular event. And that for me was a paradigm shift in how I thought about training, how I thought about performance. And then like all this stuff kind of like started rolling in my head about all the basketball players that I've kind of, you know, played with, against, you know, some of these Sudanese boys here in Adelaide, man. The guy weighs like 50 kilos. His thighs like literally this big. And he's got a 45-inch vertical. And I'm like, that makes no sense. What is making you jump, man? I don't understand. And then I started reading about some of the African tribes who basically just jump in their spot. There's like a dance for them. And that's kind of like practice. So some of that connective tissue gets stronger. Other things than muscle starts to work really, really well. And so I thought, you know what, man, what have I got to lose? Went into my garage. I couldn't do anything. You know, I was in a moon boot, this fat boot, which had like an elevated heel to protect the ankle. And over time, the heel would drop, and that was kind of the recovery. And I started benching 3 times a day. And I had good results after. So I was in a moon boot for about four or five weeks. And I gained on the bench press from benching 3 days, three times a day. And that to me was like an incredible aha moment. And then once I got healthy and back on my feet, I started experimenting with push-ups, pull-ups. This is kind of before I started making proper videos. And I didn't really document this stuff really well, although in my journals, I wrote a lot. I write a lot in my, journals. I've got two full books that I just write. And so some of those ideas I've captured live, if you will, as I went along. And some of those paragraphs were really passionate. I really felt this grease in the groove thing was just a completely different thing for me. And so then I started looking into other Eastern ideologies, you know, Russians, Bulgarians. And that's kind of how I started to dream about, you know, maybe I belong to the Eastern method. This is way, I didn't understand anything about steroids. I didn't, like, none of these things I knew anything about. I was just like, cool, let's train. Like, I love to train. I love playing basketball. So now why don't I start lifting weights kind of like I played basketball, practice. And that's kind of what sparked this whole idea, man. Like, you know, I wanted to document the journey of practicing weightlifting or just simply squatting. That's kind of the lift that I really fell in love with.
And do you feel that greasing the groove can work on any movement, or is it suited best for specific movement patterns?
Yeah, I think calisthenics movements is where that really, really shines. Unless you are employed at home, I don't know, your social and your work life needs to kind of cater to it, but you need to be doing squats like 4, 5, 6, 10 times a day, you know, so accessibility is a big problem. So I think push-ups, pull-ups is great. And I think it's great up to a certain level. You know, I made a bunch of videos where I kind of did it for a little while. I got okay at it, but then there was a level where it stopped working for me. And then me being impatient, I started kind of adjusting Pavel's ideas on the fly with thoughts that I thought would work. And I started kind of creeping up that intensity of each set. And so I started to feel the pump, you know, some of these sets. And Pavel always used to say, if you feel the pump, you ain't doing it how I want you to do it. You can't have a pump. That's a muscular thing you're doing. We're training the nerves. And so I started feeling the pump. And then as you start doing that, obviously recovery issues start to happen. Like if you go to pump every single day, that's not going to last long. It's going to catch up with you. So then I ultimately gave it up, and I reckon I got to 70 push-ups. That was the best I got. So, you know, that was a nice little basically segue into high-frequency training. I mean, Pavel's ideas were very, very high-frequency. But then I started reading about the Bulgarians, and I thought, wow, okay, so you don't have to, you know, go 36%. You can really go max every day. So I thought, I want to try that. Let me go, you know, the Bulgarian style of this high-frequency training. The Bulgarians also train three times a day, although, you know, we didn't really know at the time, but the Bulgarians that Ivan Abijev, the national coach, the guy that came up with this method, he was working with guys that were already like national level champions. Like they were really, really advanced. And here I was trying to do it as a beginner / intermediate. So I don't think the true Bulgarian is doable for somebody that is not elite level anyway. But, you know, I gave it a go. I experimented. I had periods when I was on annual leave where I did it for a week straight, where I tried to squat three times a day. That was brutal, man. I was napping most days in the middle of the day. Like I was just wrecked, absolutely wrecked.
That's funny. So I actually did greasing the groove when I started to do pull-ups, like way back in the day. And I actually don't know where I heard of it. It definitely wasn't from a book. I think someone just told me about it. And I think my goal was to like get to like 15 pull-ups. And yeah. I found it worked. I don't think I did 30%. I was probably doing like 50%.
Yeah.
So probably more than recommended, but I think it is really good for a movement pattern that you can't do a ton of reps on, like calisthenics. Like if you can't do a lot of pull-ups and your goal is to do weighted pull-ups, let's say, for example, like you need to get to the point where you can do like 10 to 15 body weight. So how do you do that? You can't do that by doing max sets of four, right? Like if you can do four, you should do two and do that until you turn that four into six, and then you turn to three, and then you have to kind of build that up. So I actually think it's a really good way to kind of build up that skill component where that skill is required.
Yeah, and that's kind of where the gains are, right? The neural adaptations, or as I say, the new gains. The new gains is basically, you know, my experience is mostly a neural adaptation. That's kind of the big spike initially when people start lifting. It's like, okay, the nerves have kind of worked out what to do here, and they're coordinated a lot better than previously. And so once you kind of, get good at the movement, then you start getting into the muscular part of the equation more so. Do you have enough fuel and contractile tissue to actually do the work? Even though you're, you know, I always think about it like the wiring in a car. Even though the wiring is there, if you're freaking trying to rev the living hell out of the four cylinder engine, you can't catch up to a Ferrari that way, man. Like you can have the best timing, the best CPU, and the best timing of the engine, all that. You're getting 100% of the four cylinders. You know what I mean? Like, and that's kind of what I remember Pavel used to have this analogy. You know, most people nervous systems are so asleep. And so you might have a six-cylinder engine, but you're running really three because the timing is so bad. The computer work is real bad. You need to put that thing on a dyno and get it really, really spot on. So every piston is perfectly timed. The firing is excellent. And so he was like, with this type of training, you'll be able to run maybe five cylinders. So now you're maximizing what you got. And I think if you're in MMA, if you're in a sport where weight matters, and he spent a lot of time, in the field of like training military, you know, soldiers and people in the field. Nobody wants a bodybuilder to go like middle of Afghanistan on a mission, and he needs to have like a whole buffet behind him of food. You know, a guy that needs to have 10,000 calories soldier, right? You want somebody that can live off a freaking protein bar, right? So, you know, if you're building a killing machine, you want somebody that is as light as possible and as strong as possible, because that guy's not going to need a lot of resource to do work. But you look at some of these bodybuilders, man, they go like 16 meals a day. Like that is not a weapon. That's a liability to anything in real life. So I think, you know, Pavel was like, okay, how do I get these guys strong without putting on a huge amount of mass? And so he basically said, look, the pump is an absolute enemy. We don't want this glycogen. We don't want this fluid retention or sarcoplasmic hypertrophy just accumulating around the body. We just want contractile tissue. And we want to be strong as possible. And then so we can go into the UFC, we can go into the judo competitions and all this sort of stuff, keep our weight as little as possible. As you know, like, I don't know if you watch UFC, like having extra weight or weight that is not really being used, it's a disadvantage, man. You got to bring oxygen to that much muscle and you tire out and then you're cooked, man. Like once your lungs and heart, you know, go because you're this 120, 130 kilo monster, you can't keep up with that, you know.
For sure. And just want to move back to basketball for a second. I think what's interesting is, so when I was in high school, we used to wear like ankle weights and practice jumping. And then there was these thing called jump soles, and they were supposed to make you jump higher. It was kind of, you know, like greasing the groove, because it's a technique. You're not going to failure, but you're just practicing everything with these additional weights.
Yeah.
And I think it improved all of our verticals somewhat, but, you know, went from not touching the rim to like grabbing the rim or like dunking a small ball, but I never got to dunking a real ball.
Yeah, I remember there was a guy, he was in my brother's age group, we played for the same club, and there was this one guy that would always wear him in training, and I think he was doing a program back in the day called Air Alert. I don't know if that was a popular thing around you know, where you grew up, but there was this program called Air Alert, and it was a whole stack of exercises you would do every single day, like calf raises, step ups onto a chair, and hops, you know, like plyometric type of stuff. So he was like going crazy with this. And I remember, like, in 1 year he developed these calves, and he all of a sudden he had these like huge calves, you know, basketball build. He was playing Division I under 18s. But he had these calves. But he was like, man, I got these calves, but I still can't jump. And so, like, there was this misconception that calves gives you the vertical leap. And I remember, like, I'm watching Allen Iverson, I'm watching Jordan, I'm like, well, those dudes didn't have calves like you. You got these calves now, but all the guys that I'm watching, they don't have these fat freaking bodybuilder calves. So, no. Like, I think that's wrong. And so then he was like, you're right. He just wanted to jump higher. It's not like you're going to make professional just because you can dunk. So then he got these ankle weights. And the ankle weights really, really did something for him.
Yeah.
He started dunking on fast breaks. He started, like, being athletic. And I was like, wow, okay. So all of these other exercises that you did didn't really carry over. But these – and the weights were very, very light. They were not heavy weights. Yet they did something to him. You know,
yeah, I think they were like 2 pounds, the ankle weights we had. We just walked around school with them on for a bit. And like, you just do your day-to-day life. No one really notices they're on. They're like below your jeans or your tearaways or whatever. And then you take them off and you have, you know, a few more inches of vertical after a couple months.
Yeah. I mean, to me, it was like initially I thought it's a gimmick. But yeah, guys around the place had, you know, really, really good benefits. I don't know, like, it was strange, but you know, I never see that anyone else, like, you know, I follow basketball NBA very, very closely. I never see them around. No one does them anymore,
so it's kind of like there's probably better stuff. I'm gonna move directions here. So you're obviously known for squatting every day, and you even mentioned the book Squat Every Day by Matthew Perryman. Can you tell me what has gone better than expected and what's gone worse than expected on your journey of squatting every day?
Yeah, man. Oh, dude. When I first started squatting every day, man, I was like, I'll do this for 30 days. It's a funny story behind that. Like, we just moved into this house and it had a really old shed. My plan was to knock that shed down, build a new one. And so we did that like after 3 or 4 months. Concrete was drying. And the squat every day one, was me not doing anything for like 2-3 months. I was going to the gym infrequently. Got a membership for the first time in like, ever, the previous 10 years, I think. And I was so keen to train that I was like, you know what, man? I'm just going to squat and let's see how it goes. And I had so much fun, like, had new garage, fresh concrete, put the squat rack together, started squatting. And I was so keen that I was like, man, I want to squat again in the PM. I'm like, no, let's not be stupid. I'm probably going to be sore tomorrow. And so then, the following day, I was like, I'm going to squat again. And I thought, let's squat every day for 30 days. And that's how it started. And, you know, at the time, I had limited knowledge about a lot of these different things. I mean, as you evolve as a human being, you learn as you go along, right? Initially, I thought it was going to have these incredible improvements. Like, if I was to practice free throw shooting every single day, for X volume of shots. Let's say I'm doing 500 free throws every single day. It's a purely a skill acquisition event. I'll be good. But it wasn't like that. You know, after, I don't even know, after like 20, about 15 days, 2 weeks of taking it slowly, because I was kind of afraid of the DOMS, you know, Matthew Perryman talks about, you know, you're going to hit a slump. Your nervous system is going to like freak out. Your body's going to start to kind of break down, so like start slow. So I started slow, and then around day 30, I want to say, if I can remember correctly, I started getting niggling pains in my hip. And so the real story about this journey has been my evolution of understanding and treating mostly the hip problem. But I've had this like hip problem come and go. Every single time I would ramp up training and go hard, it's almost like the hip flare up. And then I'm like, okay, I'm going to take it easy for a while now. So then I'll go back down and reduce the volume and reduce all the hard yakka. And then I'll feel better again. And then I'll try again. And then in this period, for the length of the journey, I would try all these different exercises. Oh, maybe the quads are weak, or maybe I don't have enough hip internal rotation. Maybe it's external rotation, and all these different thoughts, watching a lot of YouTube, you know, reading a lot of forums, understanding, can you really do this every day? And then eventually I worked out after many, many years of trial and error, how I can survive doing a lot of volume. Because even before the squat every day period, I would have periods where I would do the Texas method. And the Texas method would like progress over a few weeks, and I'll get into like a really, really heavy period. And I would have this hip pain. But at the time, because I was training less frequently, I just thought it was just DOMS. I just thought it was, well, that's what people feel when they squat. And then, you know, when I started squatting every day, I was like, oh my God, so this thing's actually, it's a problem. It's not a good type of pain. So I kind of had it for a long time. Maybe even I had it during the basketball days. I'm not sure, you know. But the squatting every day gives you the points every single day. And it allows you to experiment every single day. And then it allows you to map out what works and what doesn't work. So that's kind of what basically kept me going all this time. Because I was like, I've got this problem. This hip pain is bothering me. I can rest, or I can come in and try. Okay, before today's squat, I'm going to do some hamstring curls. I'm going to do like 5 sets of 10 hamstring curls. Then I'll go into my squat routine and work up to like 75-80%. And see if that changes things. Oh, okay. So that kind of felt better than yesterday because I just did hamstring curls. And so then I started using like all these different ideas of, okay, hamstring curls work. Okay, what if I do leg extensions? Oh, no. That's really, really bad. Squats felt horrible. And you can see in my journal, like I'll literally write this feedback under each of the lines of, you know, what I did in the day. I'll write, okay, this really exacerbated my hip pain. And then over the course of the months and years, I developed this like data set of information where I had things that made my hip really bad and things that were really, really good. And so then I started filtering through all the stuff. And eventually I came down to some sort of solution that I thought worked well. And so now I decided this year, I know it's freaking crazy. It's a crazy story, man. Like after 4 or 5 years, since the start of this year, I've had barely any hip pain, and I've been going nuts with training. So I feel like I'm on top of it. But I think this pain, no pain has kind of drawn me into coming in every single day and working on it. It's kind of weird. Like, you know, some of the guys have been following me, that they always say, you know, Ivan and the hip pain legend, you know. That's kind of been the story in a way.
Fair enough. I also feel like there's something around habits and momentum. Like, just, you got like a streak going. It's been so long. It's ingrained. Can you maybe just elaborate on, you know, building and maintaining habits and maybe the power of momentum if you feel like there's something there?
Without a doubt, man. Without a doubt. I say to everyone around me, man, you know, that people know this about me. I always say it is far easier to train every single day than 3 days a week, man. Because when you're training every single day, there is no conversation in your mind. There's nothing. You know you're training every day. But when you're training a couple of times a week, you're like, it's freaking raining outside. It's cold as anything, man. I got this on, that on. I will do it tomorrow. So there's a conversation all of a sudden. There's room for dialogue in your brain, whether you go or stop. When you train every single day, you wake up in the morning, you're like, okay, so when am I going to do this? Where can I fit this in the day? Like, this is happening. Speak to my wife. Hey, what are we got on today? Oh, it's a really, really busy day. I've got work. And then after work, we've got all these events. Cool, no worries. I'll get up at 5 a.m. This is my window. So I wake up 5 a.m, get up, flick the lights on, do my thing for 45 minutes to an hour, shower, get on with my day. So, you know, the mentality is, I feel like my job is easy, man. Like, I wake up and I'm like, okay, when am I going to do it? Not, are you going to do it? So I think from the willpower, my willpower doesn't get exercised at all. Like, there's no willpower in it, man. Like, no. You know, where if you have a choice, then it becomes really, really tricky. And I think you can see this in other parts of human behavior. When you give people too much choice, you know, it's almost like they're unhappy. They get spoiled, and you know, the human brain almost can't compute a lot of that stuff. But when there is no choice, you just get on with it, and there's almost like less stress about your existence. This is the way things are done around here, and you go and get on with it. But if there's 100 freaking different things you can be doing, you're like, okay, I'll do this one. And then you're worrying about all the other things that you're missing out on. So I think from the mental side of it, there's definitely that element. You know, I'll just do it. And then on days where I really, really struggle and maybe I'm sick or maybe the hip pain is really kicking my ass, man, like you know, this is a big, big component of me and the channel. I work as a nurse in emergency. So I see death and suffering very often. And often, you know, I finish my shift and I'm like, man, I've got it good in life. You know, we always joke around at work. The best thing about nursing and medicine in general is that you go home and you're like, I'm doing all right, man. Like, I'm really okay in life. Like, that dude there, he needs to go to dialysis 3 times a week. He can't walk more than 15 meters. Misery. It's just misery. And here I am. I'm like, am I going to squat or not? This is just like the level of hardship in my mind when I do the contrasting, you know, thoughts. Of course I'm going to do it, dude. Like, that guy over there, like, I'm blessed. I'm absolutely blessed. And so that kind of gets me out of it, out of the negative feedback kind of thoughts that you might have. And we all have them. You know, we all have them. Even for somebody that doesn't have to discuss training daily, some days I feel sorry for myself. Oh, my God, man. Like, yeah, I feel sorry for myself. It's so bad. I got it so bad. And then I think to myself about the guy that I put in a body bag 3 days ago at the body. And I'm like, well, I am lucky. And then it's an abnormal experience. 99% of the population doesn't have to, you know, worry about this stuff. But when you constantly see death, when you constantly see suffering, it does something to you, dude. Like, I can't explain it. And maybe part of the squatter day journey is also my therapy. We kind of spoke about this before we started recording. Maybe it's therapy as well. You know, some people go back to the bottle or to the smokes or whatever. And when I have a really shitty day, man, I just put 180 on the bar and do an AMRAP set, and then freaking hell, man, everything is mint. I feel bloody beautiful after that. All of the negative energy leaves me, and I sit there and I appreciate everything, man. I appreciate my life. And so there's multiple elements into what drives me. I can't believe it's been 1,700 days.
It's crazy.
Sometimes I wish I want to quit it all for one day and then restart it, purely because I'm sick and tired of writing such large numbers every single day. 1,700 days. I don't want it to be about the streak. I want it to be, you know, I want to do this, you know. And a lot of people think, oh, you're going for 2,000. When I was on 800, you're going for 1,000. I'm not going for anything, man. One day life is going to be like, you have to stop this for whatever reason. Sure. You don't ever know what the future is. And then when I'm forced, I will stop. You know, and that's it.
Yeah, it's like the streak is a byproduct of
exactly
the work and doing it. And I think where you talk about working in emergency, you actually said this story and it kind of gave me like chills. You mentioned that, I guess, where you live is like the meth capital of the world. And that you had a patient who was up for 4 straight days on meth, but working.
Yeah.
And to me, that was like, that was just crazy.
Man, I don't know what it is about Adelaide, South Australia. There are some regional towns around Adelaide that have had, like, you know, South Australia is a very sporty part of Australia. I think country towns in Australia in general are very sporty and produce a lot of talent for the Australian Football League here. And a lot of basketball players come from country because it's almost like, you know, people go to school, you know, kids go to school Monday to Friday. And then on the weekends, there's nothing else to do but play sport. And so this huge, you know, grassroots development through there. But, you know, there's regions now in the last 15 years. I work with some colleagues that have, you know, grown up in some of these areas where they don't have enough kids between the ages of under 12, under 16 to have a competition. All of these kids are methed out. You know, they're all on meth now. That's what they're doing now. So, you know, they don't play basketball or netball or footy or whatever. They just get the pipe going. You know, so there's whole generations that are being absolutely poisoned, essentially erased, because these people are not going to amount to do anything. You know, meth is, I've said this many times before, meth is so addictive that it's, you know, to give you an understanding of the endorphin release, a natural human being, let's say the best thing we can feel naturally is an orgasm, right? That's like sexual orgasm is the best thing we can feel. And let's call that 10 out of 10. Mm-hmm. Well, a hit of meth is 16-fold that feeling.
No.
So, you know, you have one shot of that and you're like, your neurology, your chemistry changes. Now you have a different scale. And so now you can have, you know, make love with your partner or whatever, but it's not quite the pinnacle of existence. You now know there is something out there that is unbelievable. And so people, obviously, like any addiction, you take 1 point, then you take 2 points, and then it progresses, and eventually your teeth fall out, skin. It's basically a zombie disease. If you see somebody who is a seasoned meth user, they look like they're 30, 40 years more aged. It's insane. It's insane. And then you have people who are like, well, I can't afford cocaine. So, and cocaine is, you know, historically been a clean drug. You know, it's a fairly clean
stimulant. It's a rich person drug, right?
Yeah. You know, it's very clean. It doesn't have the effects that meth does. But meth is so cheap. You can basically cook it up in your bathtub. You just go to one of the local shops, pick up some fertilizer and all this other crap, and you can basically make meth in your bathtub. And a lot of people do. It's just simple tools. So the cost thing is theirs. And so, like, the story that I told of that guy working at the pizza bar, he did his shift. The boss is like, hey, man, can you do a double? The guy called in sick, and we got no one else to take over. You're the main guy. Like, this, you know, I can't shut this thing down. He's like, yeah, no worries. I'll do a double. The double turned into a triple. And then he started taking a bit of meth. And basically, he was a well-adjusted human being. Like, he wasn't an addict. But he ended up working 4 days straight in this restaurant. And I'll never forget him. He came in with chest pain. And I thought, my God, you're lucky to be alive. 4 days meth bender. He came in with chest pain. And I mean, and then, oh, so he 4 days worth of staying awake. And then he slept for something like 24 hours. And he woke up and he had chest pain and his bloods were all whacked. And I mean, he was lucky to be alive. But this is kind of some of the stories that you kind of see and rub shoulders with these people on a daily basis in emergency. It's quite a unique experience.
Yeah, absolutely. It's crazy. Yeah, unfortunately, when I lived in the San Francisco Bay Area, fentanyl is a huge problem there. You could see it in the city. The city's changed. No one wants to go to the city anymore. It's unsafe. Everyone's like a zombie. That's same thing. It's happening in the teenage years. Like, it's sad to see.
It's just, I've heard about San Francisco from celebrities. And I mean, I don't live in America, but people have said that it's shocking, absolutely shocking. I don't know what they have to do, but they have to do something.
I know a lot of people that moved out of the area, especially like females who just felt really unsafe. Yeah. You know, single females who worked in tech and they're like, I can't live here anymore. They moved to like Texas or something, like they're like, we can't stay here anymore.
I think, you know, addiction and that kind of stuff, struggling with substance abuse, I think these people, I don't know, I think there's deeper society problems that lead to this stuff. I think addiction is a symptom of a deeper problem. Something that I've kind of learned over the years. I remember, you know, in my early part of my nursing career, I would see somebody that's 30 weeks pregnant and on meth. I'm like, my Lord, man, like, what is going on? I'll get angry at these people. Like, internally, obviously, you can't have that sort of behavior in front of a patient, but I'll get internally really, really, it would bother me. And then over the years of maturing and understanding things, you kind of understand that a lot of people that go to these things are almost looking for an escape to their reality. You know, if you're happy and you love your kids and you love your life, you have a fantastic life, there's no reason for you to do these substances. You're already happy. You're fulfilled.
Yeah. It's easy to not do the substances when your life is going well, right? So it's hard to put yourself in someone else's shoes and saying, why are they doing that? Yeah. Life might be really tough.
And, you know, and then you read some of these people's stories and, you know, you dig deeper and you're like, all right, cool. So the uncle raped her at 9 years old. So there's PTSD, there's trauma there. She's now developed into a full human being. Hates all men, is going to therapy, nothing's really, you know, working for her. So she's like, I just want to escape just for a little bit. Let me escape for a little bit. And then you try a little bit. And then once you experience the first hit, then it's a 50-50 whether you're going to be a druggie for life or it's really sad. I mean, a lot of this stuff comes from trauma. And, you know, I don't live in America, but I know a little bit about the struggles of that lower tier of society in America, to know that, you know, there's some problems there, there's problems here as well, but it's that bottom part of society that are susceptible to drugs, you know, especially like these type of drugs that take your soul, you know.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think cost of living has gotten crazy, and then the, you know, it just has created this huge wealth gap, and it causes issues. But I'm going to move back into trading, a little bit more fun conversation here. So I'm going to throw out some quotes you've said in the past, and just tell me your first initial thought. So the first one here is, it doesn't matter which rep range you get strong, strength is strength.
The first thing that comes to my mind when I hear that is, absolutely. If you get strong in any rep range, you will communicate with all other rep ranges. And the first person that I thought about then was George Lehman. I don't know if that guy is a familiar name in your mind.
No.
George Lehman, man, this guy was around like 10 years ago. He was a deadlift holder. American deadlift holder, I think. He deadlifted like 900 pounds, 99 something, big boy. And he was the first guy, maybe I'm misquoting him, but he was the first guy to come up with this progressive range of motion. Was it Prince or something like progressive range of motion or PROM a program? So it was something like that, where he basically said, okay, put your goal number on the bar. Let's see, we're talking about the deadlift. Put it in the rack and make the pin so high that you can lift this ideal number that you want. Say you want to lift 500 pounds and you can only do 400 off the floor. Put 500 on the bar and move it this much. This is your range of motion. This is your range of motion. Do that for a few weeks and then extend the range of motion to this much, to the next pin. And then the next pin. And so the weight stays fixed and you just keep adding a little bit more range of motion. And you're doing like sets of like 10 with this stuff. You're repping out because it's such a range of motion, such a small range of motion, and you know, you can overpower it. So George was the driving force in this thinking. And one of the things he said was, and this is how he got to 900 deadlift, was he would literally, at the start of his block of training, he would do sets of 30. So there was a range of motion principle that he used. And on the side, he would also do like RDLs for sets of 30. And then you start there. And then over the 12 weeks, you reduce that to 25, to 20, to 18, to 15. And you keep going down. And he used to say, if you get stronger in a set of 30, you have the potential to also be stronger with a set of 3 or a set of 2 or a set of 1. You just need to give it time and kind of transition that fitness into singles, doubles, and triples. So any rep range where you get stronger than before, you are technically stronger, but not right now in the one rep max. And so he was the one, as soon as you said that, I thought of George Lehman. He was the guy that taught me that and made it seem okay to do rep work. It's not just cardio.
Awesome. All right, next one here. We are what we are repeatedly do. Excellence is then not an act, but a habit.
Oh, man. Aristotle. That quote, I heard it a long, long time ago, and it's written on my squat rack, and I look at it every day. It's my favorite quote. And then over the years, I've read some stuff that Aristotle wasn't the guy that came up with this. It was some other guy later down the track. But I think the initial idea is was Aristotle. It's my favorite quote, and my basketball brain takes a lot of pleasure from that quote because I love the idea of practice. I love the idea of practice. Just putting in the reps. That to me is just, I love it.
Awesome. Okay, I think this one's interesting. Auto-regulate your training to go to sleep.
Or ready to train to go to sleep. I'm just trying to think in more context that was.
I think it was like if you are not sleeping well, maybe you need to adjust your training.
And the
frequency and the intensity so you can actually get to sleep.
That's Matt Perriman's thoughts, I'm sure of it. Matt Perriman was so Matt Perriman is a fellow from New Zealand. He's an author. I think he's got a PhD in philosophy, I think. A field that is unrelated to medicine or you know, health and fitness or anything like that. But he definitely has the academic mind. And so, like you and I, you know, have this hobby on the side. He had this hobby on the side, training. And he fell into it and he started researching and researching. And he came up with, he discovered a lot of these neurological components to training and what it meant. And he basically said that, you know, auto regulation is one of the things that makes you able to survive a high frequency training session. Don't be so, you know, sold on arbitrary numbers that some guy has written in a completely different lifestyle, completely different world. There's 8 billion people on the planet. It's unlikely that we all can survive doing the same damn thing. There needs to be some sort of variation, some sort of auto regulation. You need to have the individual a little bit of wiggle room to survive. We can't be all boxed in. And he had some really nice science to kind of back that up. And I think that's probably where that quote comes from. If you don't auto-regulate, you probably lose sleep over it.
Yeah. So I find auto-regulation really interesting because I think in my day-to-day life, I'm better at auto-regulating than most people. Like I almost have an empty calendar each day and I kind of just go by feel on what work needs to be done. That's just how I live my life. And I think it would drive a lot of people crazy because I'm still productive, but I think it would cause people stress. But then with my training...
You would make a really good emergency doctor or nurse, like, because we never know what patient's going to come through the door. So you look up to work. I don't know what's going to come through the door. So I kind of live basically like you.
Yeah. So like even after this, like there's different things I'm working on with my app. There's like product design. There's like some AI stuff. There's some go to market. Like I'm not sure exactly what I'm going to work on today. I'm just going to see what feels right. But I actually have more of a challenge doing that in the gym, because if it says on my spreadsheet that I need to do the third set, I'm going to do the third set because there's this mental side of me that thinks that if I don't do it, that I'm like being weak because that's what's written. So I'm actually really good at the auto-regulation in day-to-day life. I'm not as good at it in a training capacity.
Immediately, you make me think about the Texas method, the 5x5, man. So, you know, you go up in weight over the following days and weeks, and then eventually you get to a period where it is a bloodbath. You know, 5 sets of 5 would something like, you know, when the weight really got heavy, I would spend an hour and a half doing these 5 sets. Like, I just did one set and it took my soul. And I'm like, how am I going to do the next set? What I should have done is, you know, restarted the program and, you know, ramp up again. But I'm like, no, I can do it. I can do it. And so auto regulation now, Pavel Tsitsula and Matt Perriman, when they started talking about that, I automatically started thinking about that period of my life where I was getting anxiety 2 days before the session, knowing that I need to do 5x5 with 160. I can't do that. And so I would fight and just gut my way through it. And I think that anxiety that you carry with you probably does you more harm than the training station is going to bring you positivity. I would lose sleep over this stuff. It's similar to when I did the milk and squats program. That whole anxiety thing was, I can't handle that, man. I just simply can't handle it. And that's why I like it. You know, every day I walk into the gym and I'm like, okay, cool. What do I feel like today? And not even then do I know what I'm going to do. Let me warm up with the bar, put 60 on, 120, 100, 120, 140. And then when I get to around like 60, 70% of my one rep max, I'm like, aha, this is the type of day I'm having. So now I have empirical evidence that this 160 kilo felt this way. Okay, so now I'm either going to do some back off work or not. And so I would often use that top single of the day as a gauge of, do I do back off work today or not? It was purely auto regulation. I did that for such a long time. And there was no anxiety, man. I just walk into a training session. I'm like, cool, let's just start warming up, man. Let's see what's in store for today. I love that. I love the fact that you have a clear calendar. That's amazing, man.
I try my best, but I can be difficult with my time. So if someone's imposing on my time, even if it's my family and I have an open block and I want to be free from a time, that's kind of one of my pressure points where I'm. I can be, let's go with challenging. Let's go. Yeah. I can be not the most pleasant person to be around when my when people try putting things in my calendar because I want it to be empty.
Yeah. You want that freedom desperately.
Yeah, exactly. All right. I got one more quote here. Mm-hmm. Where did it go? I always said I wouldn't get involved with the beefs, picking sides, because I understand a lot of it is done for the drama. I don't like response videos. We're fighting each other. I don't like when we eat our own. I don't like fighting for the sake of views.
Yeah, man. That's something that I've tried to stick with in entirety. Although I realize that people have made careers, people have made millions of dollars, especially in this fitness industry space, of just going back and forth, creating drama. There's something about drama, man. You know, my missus, my mom, you know, I always say, man, what is it with women and liking watching drama on television? Like, to me, that's upsetting. I don't want to watch drama. I want to watch, like, history. I want to watch something that I learned something from it. No, oh, he had an affair with her and, you know, drama. I don't have, I've got enough drama in NED, man. Like, let's go have my leisure as well, you know. But this is something, like, I've had a few fellas have a go at me on social media about my methods, how I live, how I what I preach, what I stand for. And some people have, you know, said, man, this guy's got no idea, he's dad bod or whatever, all this stuff. And the knee-jerk reaction in me is to, like, to respond and get into it. But I always think to myself, nothing good comes out of it. And I never want to get into a situation where, let's say, me and this guy are having a fight on social media and I absolutely obliterate him. The audience, everyone that's watching out, they're all with me. So now I've completely destroyed this guy's character. There's a few names that have had this dealt, basically. Complete destruction of their social profile. Nobody watches them. He's a laughing stock now. What if that guy, I don't know, gets into a depression and does something to himself? And now I'm like that guy that's completely destroyed him and his livelihood. I don't know if I could live with myself doing that, man. Just because academically or professionally, let's say, we have a disagreement, I have a hard time eliminating my competitors. And that's probably a flaw in me and probably why I will never be a good businessman. Because I always think to myself, man, I don't want to destroy somebody else. But, you know, this is human nature in a way. And there's many different elements and different forums where this plays out. And we used to go to war. There's always a winner. Team sports, you know, Toronto beat the Golden State Warriors, whole stack of injuries on the Warriors. Toronto wins. One team's going, yeah. The other one team's going. So there's always winners and losers. And I'm fully aware of that. But when it comes to this community of fitness, I always feel like we're on the same side. At least that's my perspective. I want to get the average Joe off the couch. I think something like 50% of Americans are overweight. 50% of Australians are overweight. So, you know, I've had some, you know, I was an elite basketball player as a child growing up. So I've got this athletic background. And for me to squat every day is not even a big thing, man. Like, I wanted to go to the army. I wanted that, you know, military lifestyle. I love that stuff. I want to be professional. I want to work, like, you know, on my body professionally. To me, that's not a problem. But for that average Joe that doesn't have the athletic background, doesn't understand training, for me to tell him, hey, listen, man, the hardest thing for you is to actually get off that couch and walk into the gym. That is the hardest thing. And when you get to the gym, just hop on the first machine and do a couple of reps. And I guarantee you at that point, soon as that blood starts to rush around the body, you start to feel a little bit better. So I think 99% of the world right now are not elite barbell operators. So, yeah, we can kind of discuss whether 5x5, whether bro splits or upper, lower or whatever. We can go to war on these things. As long as we don't go personal, as long as we don't attack somebody personally, because I always think to myself, okay, what if I go, you know, I've had some people basically threaten me. And I've got three kids and a wife. I don't want to have the thought of somebody, you know, getting involved in my personal life and tracking me or whatever. So I'm always mindful of that. You know, I'm like, cool, I'm not going to make enemies on the social media, because screw all of this crap. This is a video game to me, man. Like, the real concern for me is my children and how they grow up and the safety of my wife and all of that stuff. So I've had some people like message me like, man, I'm going to fly you and your boy to the UK, and I'm going to beat the hell out of you. You know, like, what, all this stuff. And all we did was like have a disagreement about whatever the topic was. This was a few years ago. So I'm like, man, I don't know the maturity level of some of these people. You know, what if it goes my way? So I stay away from all beefs. Although, you know, if you look at the social media space, some of the biggest channels are the ones that are beefing constantly.
For sure. And I think when you make a channel, you can choose how you want to act and behave. I don't think disagreement necessarily is a negative thing, but I think if you're, like, when I look at my channel, I want the people who are watching this, people who want to educate themselves, get better at training, have a passion. That's the people that I want to follow my channel. So if my content portrays that, that's who's going to end up following my content. The people who want the drama and the reactions, they're not going to watch it. This is boring to them, right? So, but I understand there's more people that like that. So you're kind of making that decision in terms of what do you want to stand for?
Exactly. No, absolutely. And that's always been my thing. I want positivity. And I love debate. This is the thing. Like, I've got a couple of mates, best mates. We've been together, you know, since I was 12 years old. And we get into it, man. Whether it's politics, whether it's medicine, pharmaceutical company, you know, the virus that we went through a few years ago, we would debate. But it's, we you know, obviously we're brothers, but we don't get personal, right? And I know them really, really well. As long as the debate is not emotional and people don't get, I don't know, there's a level to it, isn't there? You know, the academic debate is fantastic, but the next level is where you don't want to be.
Yeah, I also feel people like to act tough online, but I don't think they would necessarily say that face-to-face to another man. Sometimes I question if it's just easy to do that remotely behind a screen. Even with my friends, like, we're close. We talk more shit on WhatsApp than we do in person to each other. And these are people who are friends and close to each other. But if you're not personal, like, would you say that to me in person? I'm not saying it's like, oh, I'm going to punch you or it's going to be a big fight. But I think there is just this thing where, you know, when you're in person, you're probably more careful with your words, I think.
Yeah, I mean, who said this? Was it Mike Tyson that said it? I think it was Mike Tyson. He said something along the lines of, you would never say that to my face because you fear getting punched in the face, right? When there's a physical presence, like you and I, if we were like, you know, around one table right now, like live, like in person, theoretically speaking, if something goes really, really bad, there's physical altercation possibility.
Yeah, there's consequences. Right?
There's consequences, right? But keyboard warriors, there is no consequence. There's nothing. And so people feel, I don't know, like it's target practice.
For sure. All right. So you talk about basketball being your first love and you dreamed of being in the NBA. And I've heard you say that you think sports are crucial because sports give you that pseudo hardship, that struggle and fight, the camaraderie and life lessons. So can you talk about what you've gotten from the game of basketball?
Yeah, man. A lot. And some of these effects I feel throughout, I mean, my work on social media and definitely at work, you know, feeling defeat, feeling sadness when you lose a grand final at a basketball competition, that is so beneficial for people to experience when there's no real consequences. Working with people, trying to work out how to work with somebody that you don't like all that much, but we have a common goal, we want to win. Sacrificing for the betterment of the team, communication, all of these things I started practicing at a very early age. communicating under pressure. 11, 10, 9. I can see a double running. I can see a double coming. And there's communication now, and you have to pick your words. Where else do you experience that other than, I don't know, in the military, in emergency medicine, on the trading floor at the financial centers? Like, there's few places where you have real pressure. And I think as a child growing up, man, like, if you have that exposure from early on, I think it's, you know, it means the world. And sometimes I think to myself, when I meet somebody that is excellent under pressure at work, when there's a cardiac arrest and there's things going, like, you know, people are going nuts, like, it's everyone's rushing and it's all, you know, all hands on deck, I can almost tell which people have been in a sporting environment and which haven't. Guys that are really, really book smart, have read every freaking text there is to read about the work, but they don't have that experience as a child in these high pressure situations. And you know, so for me, like, my kids, I don't really care what they play. I honestly don't really care what they play, but team sports is absolutely crucial. You know, the hardship, you know, my boy lost by 20 points yesterday and he's gutted by it. He's like, oh my God, we lost, you know. And I'm saying to him, all right, so how are we going to get better? Driving back home in the car, we're talking about what he needs to improve. And he feels that pain in him and he really wants to improve. And now, okay, so we have this hardship and now we have a path to fix this hardship. And so now we're developing coping mechanisms. We're thinking about lots of different things. And we're talking about a basketball, insignificant to his life. But we're having these conversations, and because he's felt that hardship, my words are sticking to his brain. You know, now he's kind of listening really, really closely, trying to learn how to prevent feeling crap like that again. I'm a big proponent of sports in general, man.
Yeah, I also think there's something special about team sports, because a lot of people in our industry are doing, you know, if they're doing like bodybuilding, for example, it's a really one-person game, right? I play tennis. It's a one-person game, but there's something about team sports specifically, I think, where you learn a lot of communication. Like, you're going on the bus with people, you're communicating on the court. There's 10 to 20 people that you're thinking about what they're doing on the court. So I actually feel there's something special about team sports specifically that you don't learn in individual sports.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how many times you know, we've lost because of my teammates' mistakes. You know, it's now I'm like, okay, how do I get him better? How do I communicate? How do I instill? How do I inspire? How do I choose my words in a way where he doesn't shit himself for those free throws and there's only 4 seconds left? What can I say to him? I mean, there's so much to it. So much to it. You know, when I think about my childhood, you know, amongst many other things, I think the biggest highlights have always come through sport for me. You know, the basketball trips to different cities. You know, I played Division I from under 14s all the way through to men's. So, you know, good competitions, family trips. It was definitely the highlight of my childhood. And my parents moved heaven and earth to make sure that my basketballing was untouched and always supported.
Yeah, we were talking about things like addiction earlier. I feel like playing sports kept me out of trouble.
Yeah, that's another one, man. That is another one. So we came to Australia in 1998. I was 9 years old. And so people that came from Yugoslavia after that civil war, lots of trouble, lots of destroyed people mentally and physically. And so we come to Adelaide, there's a whole community of Serbians, Croatians, and Bosnians. And the first thing my parents and everyone does is they go to that community, those town halls on Fridays and Saturdays, and you mingle with those people. And a lot of these kids are byproducts of their parents. And for some reason, a lot of them got into gangs, right? Gangs, you know, we have bikies here. I don't know if bikies are a thing in America much, but they're kind of like the biggest gangs. And next minute, you know, criminal, you know, there's a 16 or there's an 18-year-old boy driving a Mercedes-Benz. You're like, well, how did he get that, you know? But I was too busy to hang out with those kids on Fridays and Saturdays because I've got basketball on Friday nights and Saturdays I've got training. And if I really want to be good at that Friday night basketball, I got to get up on a Sunday morning as well and go for a beach run and do the sand dunes. So I was like so focused on being really, really good at basketball that I was like, do you want me to go where? Do you want me to go to city and just hang out and waste time? What do you mean, man? Like, I want to get good at basketball, man. Like, I don't want to just go out. What are you going to do? I was going to go hang out. What do you mean hang out? So I was always kind of like, I'll hang out with the boys that have similar kind of interests. We all want to go to the NBA, you know?
Yeah.
As a fantasy that is, but that was kind of our mission then.
Yeah, I had a friend who had the key to his church, and his church had an indoor basketball court. Wow. So we would go play there like Friday from like 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. And then we'd go get McDonald's and slushies. And that was the evening. And it was it was so much fun, right? Because you got indoor court. Like, that was such a big deal. It wasn't a good court, but it was an indoor court. And then, you just go get McDonald's after because you don't care what you eat because you're in high school. And it's a good time.
Oh, man. When you said the indoor court, I don't know how many times I was like, I just want to play basketball without wind. I hate wind. And outdoor courts is always wind. You shoot a shot and it just takes the ball like a needle that way. So, you know, indoor basketball was a dream, man. Absolute dream. Awesome. And, you know, we don't have the same, I don't know, the same culture as America, man. America seems like there's a lot of these opportunities for people to have indoor basketball. Like, I know there's high schools out there. They have like full packed out gyms when they play, you know?
Yeah, I'm in Canada. It's not like that. Probably more like Australia where you know, sports are a big thing, but it's not an event. Yeah, at the university college level, it's not an event. Like it's trying to get there, especially Canadian basketball is getting a lot of better players. Like we have, you know, Shea, we have Jamal Murray. Like it's getting better, but when I was growing, I think the new generation was inspired by the people who made it in our generation. Like growing up in Toronto, like Vince Carter was such a big deal for us growing up. But I feel before that, we didn't have leagues and stuff like that. Like it was more like house league. And like it wasn't what it is now where kids are getting trained at five for serious basketball and things like that. So
It's taken off. Yeah, I guess Canada sounds a lot like Australia. In Australia, we've got this thing called AIS, Australian Institute of Sport, and they've done a lot of work. So, like, they identify talent quite early, and they'll fly them to Canberra, like the capital city of Australia. I think AIS is based over there, and, you know, they will go to school and train. And it's like, that's probably the only thing I can think of that kind of resembles the American collegiate kind of setup where, you know, they're teaching their kids how to, you know, clean and jerk. You know, these basketball players know how to clean. I never touched weights as a basketball player, ever. We just ran around laps on grass.
For sure. That's all we ever did. All right. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw some pictures on the screen here and tell me the first thing that comes to mind. If you have either a story or if this person's inspired you in some way. So this first one is four basketball players here.
Oh, my God. Yeah, man. Michael Jordan, man, he's the reason I played basketball. He is elegance. He is athleticism. He is that fadeaway jump shot. Man, he basically made basketball in my mind, you know. Growing up in Yugoslavia, it was all about football, but then I discovered Jordan. And like he's the GOAT. He's I know LeBron's good and all that, but the elegance which this man played and the way he did it, the emotional attachment I have to that career will never be touched. Then obviously Kobe Bryant, the closest copy of Jordan. he was the guy that, you know, tried to emulate MJ. And then Allen Iverson, he growing up for a lot of my years, he was my favorite player because he was small guy. I studied his moves, his change of direction, his crossover. I studied a lot of his ability to create space. So, you know, Jordan and Kobe, they're tall guys, man. Like, you know, I can't do what they do. They're just tall. Allen Iverson is my height, my weight. I can do that. And then Petr Stojakovic there at Sacramento with Vlade Divac, that was probably the most, you know, heartful team that I've ever followed in my days. You know, Belgrade's getting bombed. Yugoslavia's falling apart. And these boys are playing in the league that the country's bombing us. That series against the Lakers.
Legendary. Yeah, they lost. But yeah.
Yeah, lots of controversy.
Bad calls. Yeah, bad calls.
Bad calls and like the foul discrepancies makes me wonder, like, what if they won? What if they won their championship and two Serbian players are at the helm? The pinnacle of basketball in a country that is currently bombing their home country. That's a hard sell. Maybe, I don't know, you know, conspiracy theories. But, you know, that there's a lot of emotion for me there. Petr Stojakovic was somebody that I followed closely. Vlade Divac was already kind of at the tail end of his career. So, you know, he freaking played with Magic Johnson, you know, so I was in my nappies, you know, when that was happening. But Petr Stojakovic, he made shooting, you know, practicing three-pointers cool. He was a Steph Curry in my mind before Steph Curry because
he was Serbian. I think he was up there, right? It's like you have Reggie Miller, you had Peja, you have Ray Allen, then you get Steph, and Steph kind of, I think, blew everyone away. But before it was kind of open discussion. I think Peja won right on Dallas. He was on that Dallas team.
Yeah, that's right. He got a ring
in 2011. Yeah, he was on that team.
He got a ring in Dallas. That's kind of like really cool. But you know, all of these guys that you mentioned, Ray Allen, Reggie Miller, you know, Petr Stojakovic, they would move without the ball, get open, shoot. You know, they were spot up shooters, you know, like running around screens and whatever. But Steph Curry, man, he will give it to you any way you want, man. You know, off the dribble, off the bounce, run around corners, just unstoppable, man. And because he's so small, and this is the weird thing about it all, right? Like everyone wanted that 6'5", 6'6", 6'7", or if Petr Stojakovic 6'10", they want a tall shooter because, you know, you got high release points and whatever. But in Steph Curry's case, the fact that he's small is actually an advantage because it's so hard to keep up with his running. Little fellas running around, who's going to keep up with him, man? So his size is actually an advantage. It's unbelievable how he made that into an advantage, but he did. So here is a 6'3" guy that doesn't stop moving and he can launch it from 40. What the hell are we going to do with him, man?
Sure. All right, next here.
Yeah, Tesla. Nikola Tesla. Yeah, so he's he's one of the most smartest, cleverest people in the world. He happens to be a Serbian. He's very well loved, renowned by all Serbians. I recently read some stuff about him, actually. There was a quote that came out of it, and he was like, I think it was his mom's deathbed, the quote came from. He was like, I'm sorry, mom, for not being by your side more. I was too busy creating for the world, and all I ever got was tension and fighting and trouble. I should have been by your side more, or something like that. That man is, I don't know, him and Einstein, a quote that comes to my mind from Einstein, he was asked years ago, obviously, you know, how does it feel to be the smartest man on the planet? Somebody asked Einstein, and he was like, I don't know, you have to ask Nikola Tesla. I thought that was really, obviously, both figures are unbelievable, changed the world forever. But yeah, unbelievable mind.
I think underappreciated too.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
It's funny, you were saying Serbians. I have my friend Boyan, he always talks about Nikola Tesla. Like,
yeah.
Something He also talks about Nikola Jokic all the time. Something about Serbians supporting their own people. Like, it's a thing. Yeah, like, he's always talking about it. It's funny.
Oh, we're prideful people, man. Djokovic as well. Like, he's probably the most successful sportsman to come out of the country.
Oh, for sure. He's amazing. And you know what I like about Djokovic, too, is the mental side of things.
Exactly what I was going to say.
So sharp mentally, and he didn't have it early in his career. It's like he started below, and he just slowly kind of grinded his way up into an elite level.
It's incredible. And in a period, the greatest period of tennis, you know, Nadal, Federer.
Yeah, big three.
I mean, insane. Absolutely insane. I often say to people, man, you know, I kind of feel a bit sad that I wasn't in my adulthood, in my 90s, in 1990s, when Jordan was doing his thing. You know, kind of like sad that I was a kid. I didn't live it live. I missed the Jordan's kind of like heydays with a fully mature mind. But in a way, I'm blessed that I lived in a period with Nadal, Djokovic, Federer, Messi, Ronaldo, like incredible stuff. Incredible. And then, like, you know, some of the greatest footballing teams, you know, Real Madrid, Barcelona, like the tiki-taka team of Barcelona. I don't know if you follow football. But they're like, these are some of the greatest people in their respective sports. And they all kind of did it at the same time. It's such an unbelievable time, man.
For sure. Factor Fiction used to play FIFA and take crappy teams like Accutane Town to the English Premier League.
Yeah, man. Fact, man. Oh, dude, that is one of my favorite things. To this day, I have fond memories, man. You take absolute scrubbers and you build them all up to, like, win the freaking Champions League, man. Oh, my God. There's so much joy in that. I'll tell you a fun story, man. probably a year into my channel taking off, a guy messages me on Instagram and he's like, man, I'm a big fan of your channel, blah, 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 blah. You know, thank you so much for everything you do. Keep it up. And I'm looking at his name and I'm like, that's a familiar name. I'm like, do I know you from somewhere? He's like, oh, no, not at all. I'm like, what do you do? He's like, oh, I'm the reserve goalkeeper for Accrington City, like the team that I'm playing FIFA. And he's like a 17-year-old, 16-year-old kid. And I'm like, what? That is insane. I'm like, dude, you're in FIFA. That is unbelievable.
That's the dream. He's in the video game. That's amazing.
Yeah, I was so pumped, man. He's like, nah, it's not like that, man. Like, you know, I'm so down in leagues. Like, it's not like that. I'm like, man, you have no idea. I've spent so many years of my life playing with that team. It's just unbelievable, man. He sent me pictures, like, you know, with his training Guernsey and all this stuff. Oh, it was a wild moment. It was that's one of my favorite stories of being on social media, man.
That's awesome.
Oh, lit me up, man.
Cool. All right, next one here.
Oh man, the man, Clarence Kennedy. Oh, so he's probably the first person that I saw in my transition from basketball to the fitness community where I went, Jesus Christ, you don't have to look like Ronnie Coleman or Arnold Schwarzenegger to be strong. He just looked, I mean, he's a muscular guy, don't get me wrong, but he doesn't look like his lats come out like fridge doors, you know? He doesn't look like a monster. He looks like a normal kind of guy to me, but he's incredibly strong. That 300-kilo pause squat, you know, the all of the weightlifting feats, the jumping, the acrobatics that he used to do. I was like, man. And he's the reason why in my bio I put my goal is to, you know, squat 300 kilos. At the time, I had no idea the difficulty. This guy is an absolute genetic marvel, and I'm not. And he's been lifting ever since he was a five-year-old or whatever. But I thought to myself, maybe I can get there because, you know, he doesn't look all that huge, maybe I can get there. So I always have, you know, this respect for Clarence, and the fact that he's come out about his PED use and all that stuff like that. I don't have a problem with people using drugs as long as you don't give me false hope. That's I like that. You know, people make choices all over the place, but the people that are like lying and saying, "Oh no, you just buy my program and you can get this," you know.
Dishonest. Yeah.
Dishonest. It just, yeah. Don't tell me I can do something that I can't, because that's really going to waste my time. But if you're doing something amazing and you're doing things that, like PEDs and whatever, I can still respect that. Like, you go for it, you know, like that's fine. You're not damaging me in any way. But if you start lying to me, now you're damaging me. And I'll take insult to that.
All right. And the last thing here for today, talk to me about the power of journaling.
Oh, man. I don't know what it is about it, man, but the mind can be a mumbo jumbo place. But you put it down on paper and all of a sudden ideas are clearer. Burdens are lightened. Goals have true meaning because now they're physical. They're in physical form. They're not just flippant and passive. I definitely recommend, especially in the moment. You know, I've got my journal sitting up here. After I finish, sometimes even during the workout, I come in here and I'm like, man, I'm onto something. It's a famous thing that I would say. I'm really onto something. Like, I did this, and this happened. It's amazing how, you know. So I write down ideas hot out of the oven. And sometimes I've postponed it for whatever reason. And then I get to sit down to write some of these ideas. And I don't have that same flavor. I don't have that same energy. And then the things I write.
Yeah, it's gone.
It's gone.
It's gone. Yeah, the essence of it's gone. You might have some of the words, but it's gone. Yeah. I have a big whiteboard here. I just jot things down. Yeah. And I've done journaling in the past, and whenever I do it, I feel good, but I seem to fall off the bandwagon sometimes. So I just I'll bullet point stuff on paper or whiteboard it, just like when it's fresh.
It needs to be when it's fresh. If you let it pass, then you're basically reading history out of your brain. And your mind is a weird thing, man. Like, your mind will remember how you felt more so than the actual factual things that happened. So if you go through an experience 20 years ago, you know how that person or that event made you feel, but you don't quite remember like what was said or who did what or how it played out, but you remember how you felt. So our brain records our feelings much more concretely than actual factual things. This is why history, his story, can be misleading a lot of the times, because, you know, people are writing all sorts, you know, and that's why you need different accounts. 1,000 people writing about an event, and all of a sudden you start to kind of appreciate what's actually happened, because there's multiple different people talking about the same thing. You kind of make some sort of commonality. But when it's in your own mind about an event, if you don't write it in the heat of the moment, man, likely the story that you write down eventually is going to be not to its full essence.
Yeah. And I don't think I've ever mentioned this, but there's this thing that I learned about a long time ago. It's kind of like building anchors, right? So like, there's a reason why if you hear a song from 15 years ago, you can put yourself back in that place in time, if that makes sense. And you can, you feel it, right? It's not about the lyrics. It's about you feeling it. And for me, music's always been a big thing. So what I did when I was really productive in my 20s is I was listening to the same kind of Armin van Buuren EDM set. And now when I put it on, it kind of puts me in a state of productivity, like almost instantly, because I have so much, I don't know if it's like emotion tied to it of being productive, that there's just this feeling of it's on, okay, lock in. And I think there's something there. Like with you, it might be like the jerseys. Like, you wear the jerseys because it anchors you to a time or a feeling. Yeah. Like, there's something there that's, it's hard to put in words, but I know it's there.
It's definitely there. And that emotional thing that I talked about as well, it's like a gate. It's a gate into inspiration previously lived. The most worn jersey out of my 7-year-old jerseys that I've collected over the years is the Lakers number 8 Kobe jersey, the home one, white one. I don't know why, but like to this day, that jersey just feels like it's got history to me. And this is strange. Like some people will look at that and be like, it's just another jersey. But if you've gone through moments with that on, like I remember like plays in my mind, pick up ball, 3-on-3, where I've worn that jersey and I've done like some really cool things and it stuck with me. And every time I put the jersey on, there's like this degree of confidence, degree of like, almost like a feeling of I'm going to make it. I don't know, make what, but it's like I feel so positive about it. It's really, really strange. And then every jersey thereafter, like one of my favorite jerseys as well is the Ben Wallace jersey. I put that on and I'm like, that bloke couldn't dribble. That bloke couldn't shoot.
Wallace.
But he could rebound the hell out of it, defend the hell out of it, block out of it. Like he's a key piece to a championship team. And he had these huge freaking arms and had that little band across his freaking biceps. People were scared of him. He was a bully. Time I go to the gym, I'm like, I'm Ben Wallace, man. Like, you know, he just worked in the gym. He just lifted weights and then he played basketball. But he wasn't really it's funny how I think about it sometimes. He's not even a basketballer. Like, he's just a workhorse. He can't dribble. He can't pass. He can't shoot. The primary skills of basketball. Yet, he's a winner because he does all the other things that impact the game so well.
Yeah, that whole Pistons team is an outlier, though. They're one of the only teams to win without a real superstar since forever.
Yeah, I mean, they had Larry Brown, didn't they?
Larry Brown. They had they had Chauncey Billups, Hamilton, Deshaun, and then they had the two Wallaces. A good team, but no one standout.
And they beat the Lakers, man.
Yeah, with Malone, Payton, Shaq, Kobe, like that, just a stacked team, right? So
recently I rewatched that whole series recently on YouTube. You can you can watch some classical games on YouTube, NBA YouTube channel. And I'm like, I remember those games, but like when you watch them back now with my mature brain and everything that I've lived through, I'll know the game a lot more. I'm like, suffocating defense, man. Like this is Kobe freaking Bryant. I know he was a youngster, but this is Shaquille O'Neal. And somehow they stop these individuals. Like it's insane. Like I don't know, like unbelievable, man. Unbelievable. How do you stop Shaquille O'Neal in his prime?
All right, I'm gonna end today with a fun question. Let's make it a basketball question. What's your Mount Rushmore? Who you think are the four highest IQ basketball players of all time?
IQ?
Yeah.
LeBron is up there. He's one of them for sure.
Agreed.
Because he's my favorite player currently, I'm going to say Jokic.
Yeah, that's fine.
He is a savant of basketball, even though he loves horse racing more.
Clearly, yeah. He doesn't get back to his horses all the time.
Yeah. IQ, that's an interesting one. I'm thinking about Magic Johnson. I'm trying to think of people that didn't rely on athleticism as their main tool, and they relied on their ability to think through the game.
I have two people in mind, so I'll let you finish and then I'll give you my two people.
I'm just thinking about the Mount Rushmore or the top 10 basketball players list that I have in my mind. I've thought about many, many a time. I'm working through them. You know, I've got Jordan, LeBron,
Kareem.
I've got Kareem, and then it becomes murky after that. I've got Kareem, and then probably, I don't know, I'll always mix up the rest all over the place. But after that, I probably have Bill Russell. And then, like the next stack of people, I always mix up. I've got Larry Bird, Magic, Tim Duncan, Shaq, Kobe, Steph Curry, maybe in top 10 somewhere there. I think I said Tim Duncan, all those people kind of like going to that middle section. And there's Wilt as well somewhere in there. But like a lot of these people, I mean, they're all IQ, high IQ players.
They're not standout IQ though. I think they're just, some of them are just athletic monsters or work ethic, but it's not IQ. Like I would have like a Rajon Rondo or a Jason Kidd potentially ahead of those guys from an IQ standpoint.
Yeah, like I'm thinking one of the names that popped into my mind was Steve Nash. Like his ability to like control the game was also insane. But I'm trying to think. I feel like I'm missing a stack of people here. Yeah, that's a great question, man. Because when you say IQ, it changes things, right? Because you know the hot names that we all have on our lips when it comes to basketball. You know, Will Chamberlain, like
the freaks. Yeah, they're freaks.
Any sport that he played, he would have been amazing at. You know, he's just a tall guy that can jump and run, and the rest is just stay injury free kind of thing. You know, amazing. But yeah, I probably lean towards the playmakers, the point guards, the Jay Kidds, the Steve Nashes, the Rondos, the Chris Pauls. Chris Paul is another one, man. Like that dude, you know, controlling the game all over the place. Off the top of my head, that's probably the list. I've thrown a whole stack of names out there, though.
Awesome, Ivan. Yeah. Thanks so much for your time today. Where can everyone find you?
Oh, YouTube is probably the best place. Ivan Djuric is the YouTube channel. I'm on Instagram as well. Ivan_Djuric_300. Those are probably my main platforms. I also have a TikTok account, which I don't upload anymore. That was kind of like a phase where it blew up. But YouTube is the main place.
Awesome. Thanks so much for your time, man. It was a lot of fun.
I appreciate you, man. Thanks for doing this.